Abortion rights struck down, gun rights expanded. Prayer on the 50-yard line of public school football fields approved. As the most momentous and controversial Supreme Court term in recent memory comes to a close, are things looking better or worse for libertarians? Georgetown Law's Randy Barnett, arguably the most important and influential libertarian legal scholar walking the planet today, applauds some of this term's rulings. But he's also worried that the new 6-3 conservative majority may be too quick to sign off on laws restricting the explicit and implicit rights of individuals guaranteed by the Constitution. In an episode of the Reason Interview with Nick Gillespie podcast, Barnett and I talked about the Dobbs decision that struck down a woman's right to an abortion, the Bruen decision that struck down a New York State law limiting the ability of gun owners to carry weapons, and other major rulings. We talk about the general direction of the Supreme Court and whether it's headed in a more or less libertarian direction. And we discuss the treatment of Ilya Shapiro, the former Cato staffer who was going to join Barnett at Georgetown until a controversy erupted over one of Shapiro's tweets, which led to him ultimately taking a job elsewhere. The university's refusal to strongly back Shapiro's speech rights, says Barnett, was shameful, but sadly indicative of where law schools are these days. Take a listen. Here's the Reason interview with Randy Barnett. Go to reason.com/podcast to subscribe. Randy Barnett, thanks for talking to Reason.
Thanks for having me back again.
Let's talk about abortion. The Dobbs decision was decided 6-3. It got rid of the federal right, or, you know, a right at the national level to abortion. You know, what's your top line response to the decision? Is it a good thing or a bad thing? Or is that the wrong way to even be talking about Supreme Court decisions?
Well, I tend not to first approach Supreme Court opinions on the basis of policy, rather more on the basis of principle. This case was a long time in coming. The conservative legal movement has laid the foundation for this the reasoning that Justice Alito used at least for 20 or 30 years. Mm-hmm. They have been questioning the legitimacy of what's called substantive due process. And you saw in the concurring opinion in this case, Justice Thomas completely repudiated any legitimacy for substantive due process. Yep. But because they believe that substantive due process is contrary to the original meaning of the Constitution, they have developed a doctrine by which they limit what it can be used for. Mm-hmm. And this doctrine, which is sometimes called the Glucksberg approach, but it actually predates Glucksberg.
Can you just very quickly, what the Glucksberg decision, what did that
That was the physician-assisted suicide case, mm-hmm. where the court held that there was no fundamental right to a physician-assisted suicide. It was a case in which I think no one dissented. I think everyone agreed with the outcome, although there were many opinions about it. But the main opinion basically said that the reason why there was no such right is because that right was not essential to ordered liberty or deeply rooted in the nation's tradition and history. Right. So this idea that a right, in order to be protected under the due process clause of the 14th Amendment, had to be deeply rooted in the nation's tradition and history, is a doctrine that's been long developing. In the Hibbs case, which was the case involving an unreasonable fine or an excessive fine under the Eighth Amendment, and the question is whether the excessive fines clause applied to the states or not. It was one of the last enumerated rights to be applied to the states. In the majority opinion by Justice Ginsburg, mm-hmm. Used the deeply rooted in the nation's tradition and history approach rubric in order to decide whether the excessive fines clause was part of the, you know, being free of excessive fines was part of our deeply rooted tradition and history. So this is a methodology that's been long developing, and I think it has always been aimed at abortion.
Right.
In other words,
so it's not that long developed. I mean, so it's really it only goes back to at the earliest, really the early 70s, right?
Right. As this new doctrine. I mean, the language itself is older than that. It borrows from language that even predates that. But the idea that this is a limitation on substantive due process, on the due process clause, using the due process clause to protect substantive rights, the fact that this is a limitation on that, that goes back. I mean, into the 90s, I would say, the 80s and the 90s.
How do you feel about that? The substantive due process, my understanding of it, and please, correct me and elaborate on it, but, there's procedural due process where laws are legitimate as long as they're passed by legislatures or representatives who are elected fairly and freely, and it's legit. And there's essentially no limit on what a majority can say, but as long as they are legitimately elected and they represent the people, and however we're talking about that. Substantive due process says there's limits to that, right? That there are certain rights that the government can never take or take away from people, or just because a majority says it's 51% says something. It's like, no, the government was actually created in order to protect our rights that can't be voted away. So how does this apply specifically in the Dobbs case?
Well, I now need to say a little more about substantive due process. Okay. There's the modern doctrine of substantive due process, and then there is the conservatives' rendition of the due process mm-hmm. clause. There's what I think the original meaning of the due process clause requires.
Okay.
So the modern doctrine is very simple to state. Judges have to identify certain liberties as fundamental, mm-hmm. and then those liberties get what you might call super duper protection,
right,
or strict scrutiny.
I really hope that you use that in all of your legal documents. SDP, yeah.
Yes, when I teach, yeah. I use super duper protection.
Yeah.
And so fundamental rights get super duper protection. Mere liberty interests, which mm-hmm. are all the other liberties we have,
right,
get virtually no protection. They get what's called rational basis protection, but it's really more like conceivable basis protection.
Right.
That's modern substantive due process. That's post-New Deal substantive mm-hmm. due process. The conservatives, the court, and conservative constitutionalists have argued in favor of what you accurately described as procedural mm-hmm. due process only, which is the idea that as long as a law is validly enacted by majorities in both houses mm-hmm. and signed into law by the governor or by the president, that's due process,
right,
when it comes to making a law. In my most recent book, The Original Meaning of the 14th Amendment, Its Letter and Spirit, my co-author and I treat each one of the operative clauses in Section 1 of the 14th Amendment. There's the Privileges or Immunities Clause, there's the Citizenship Clause, Privilege or Immunities Clause, Due Process Clause, and the Equal Protection Clause. When we talk about the due process of law in the Due Process Clause, we argue that the due process of law requires not only this fair process, this fair procedure that procedural due process supposedly protects, mm-hmm. it also requires that no one be deprived of their life, liberty, or property except by a valid law. Mm-hmm. It's the due process of law. And a mere act of a legislature is not necessarily a valid law if it's not within the scope of the legislative right. power. So the due process clause requires us to examine, is this law within the scope of the relative of the respective legislator's power? In the case of the federal government, is it within the enumerated powers of Congress? If it's not, then it's not truly a law, and therefore due process of law would say you can't be deprived of your life, liberty, or property. At the state level, it has to do with whether it's within the police power of states. So this conception of due process is substantive, not because it identifies substantive rights. That's what the modern substantive due process incorrectly does. It's substantive because it evaluates the substance of a state law or a federal law to see whether the substance of the law is within the power of the legislature to enact. Mm-hmm. And that would mean it'd have to be, if it's a state law, within the police power of the state to protect, for example, the health and safety of the public. Mm-hmm. That would be the core of the police power that everybody agrees is within the police power of states. There's disagreement about whether there's also a power to protect the morals of the public. Mm-hmm. But the idea that it's a health and safety law would be within it. So therefore, I disagree in some sense with both the substantive due process uh-huh. approach of the majority in Glucksberg, because it's operating within modern substantive due process doctrine, which says some rights are fundamental and other rights are not. Mm-hmm. They get no protection. In fact, that's the implication of Dobbs. Because they found it was not a fundamental right, it got no protection at all.
Yeah.
I disagree with that. I also disagree with Justice Thomas's concurring opinion, mm-hmm. in which he suggests that the process is only about the procedures that are followed to deprive you of a life, deprive you of life, liberty, or property.
So Alito's opinion, is it Is it right? Do you think it's accurate or do you think it is wrong?
It's extremely well. Let me first by saying it's extremely well done. Mm-hmm. It's a bit more originalist than I expected it to be. Mm-hmm. I thought when I read the leaked opinion, and I didn't read it that carefully because it was only a leaked opinion. When I read the leaked opinion, I thought, look, this is just nothing but substantive due process, mm-hmm. modern substantive due process done the conservative way. Mm-hmm. And the conservative way is to basically find no more rights being fundamental than the ones that have already been recognized. Mm-hmm. And Roe is not going to be found to be a fundamental right. That's kind mm-hmm. of what this whole thing was set up to accomplish.
Right.
But there's a little more originalism in there than I thought, because he places a great deal of stress on whether abortion was legal or prohibited in 1868, mm-hmm. when the 14th Amendment was enacted. The reason why that's originalist is because that goes to what the scope of the state's police power is. Mm-hmm. And if, for example, it was thought to be, and in fact was, within the police power of a state to handle the issue of abortion this way, then in that case, it would satisfy the due process of law, because such a law would be within the due process of law. It would be a genuine law within the police power of the states to act.
And that would suggest that a right to an abortion is not, you know, it's not part of American tradition, custom, and law.
Yes, it isn't. But the reason why it, under my not necessarily right. under the majority's reading, but I think he gets there. He almost gets there anyway. Right. Under my reasoning, the reason why there is no such right is because it would have been within the scope of the state's police power.
Right.
This does not therefore violate any rights because it's within the scope of the state's police power.
What happens if, you know, and I'm thanking my colleague Damon Root, whose work you have, you know, said admiring things about it, and you guys often agree on things, but he wrote for us, he said, Alito's decision, you know, kind of does real violence to unenumerated rights, but is also just historically inaccurate that at the founding of the country and up through a good chunk of the 19th century, abortion before quickening, you know, roughly, you know, about 20, 24 weeks was actually legal. It was not criminalized. It was not, blah, blah, blah. So that when Alito says there is no, you know, historical grounding of abortion rights in America, he's wrong, but also that simply because the Constitution doesn't mention something, it does not necessarily mean that the government can regulate it or restrict it.
Yeah, well, I agree with Damon about the latter. And mm-hmm. in fact, what the conservative approach to substantive due process basically says is unenumerated rights are highly suspect, see Roe v. Wade.
Right.
And we're not really going to recognize any more of them. And, you know, the Ninth Amendment, we're going to dismiss for some reasons, and the Privileges or Immunities Clause of the 14th, we're going to dismiss for other reasons.
Right.
I think that they do a disservice to the function that unenumerated rights ought to play in our constitutional system. As you well know, that's what I think.
Right.
On this issue of the abortion in particular, I have to stress that this is not my area of expertise. That is, I am not an expert on the history of abortion laws. Mm-hmm. I know what I know secondhand, oftentimes mm-hmm. from reading briefs or appellate court opinions, just so to be clear. Justice Alito addresses this issue by citing a couple of sources in which the laws didn't seem to discriminate between pre-quickening mm-hmm. abortions and post-quickening abortions. And we should tell everybody what a quickening abortion is. It's when there's fetal movement.
Mm-hmm.
It was without question, I believe, illegal to perform an abortion after there was fetal movement. The dispute is over whether it was also illegal beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
There are people who argue that it was. Damon is relying on scholars who make that claim. But there are others who say it wasn't. And Alito cites examples of laws banning abortion that did not make that distinction. Right. And then he says something else. He makes a move which I think is highly suspect. It's a critical move here. But I do think it's highly suspect. And that is to say, just because they didn't legislate on it, even if they didn't legislate on it, doesn't mean that anybody thought they didn't have the power to legislate on it. Well, that is going to throw into doubt pretty much any liberty that isn't mentioned in the text of the Constitution. It's going to be very difficult to sustain the burden of showing that a liberty, just because it wasn't regulated, nobody thought it could be regulated. Mm-hmm. This actually will become relevant in discussing Justice Thomas's approach to the Second Amendment in the Bruen case. But anyway, that is where, so Alito makes two critical moves in response to Damon's argument. One is to dispute the history. Right. Damon says he's got the history wrong. Alito says the other people have the history wrong. But the second thing is to make this move to say, well, even if it wasn't regulated, that doesn't mean anybody thought legislatures didn't have the power to regulate it if they wanted to. Yeah. That's a very sketchy move to make, I think. But it's one that, in fact, Justice Scalia used to make all the time.
Right.
So it's not an unfamiliar move. It's just one that I find to be suspect.
Yeah. Before we go to Thomas's discussion of substantive due process and his concurrence, can you talk a little bit about stare decisis? Because that was another concept I got talked about a lot here. And, you know, all of the newer Supreme Court justices or the people nominated by Trump or appointed by Trump, all gave at least some kind of lip service. Although, you know, when you the idea that Roe was settled law and that they're not going to mess with it. It's interesting that in a lot of the clips that I was watching on cable news and whatnot, you know, these people are lawyers. They're obviously really good at making, you know, very specific arguments that leave a lot of wiggle room and interpretation. And none of them, you know, in anything I saw said, Roe versus Wade is settled law, and I would not rule against it because it is settled law. They all say something, you know, that's much more anodyne than that. But can you discuss briefly what stare decisis is and the way in which Alito dispenses with that as a stumbling block to overturning, Roe and Casey and existing abortion kind of rights language?
Sure. Stare decisis is the idea that a current court should follow the decision of a previous court, even if the current court disagrees with the decision of the previous court. Why? Because it's precedent. And there's all kinds of arguments on behalf of precedent, stability, consistency. Right. There's epistemic considerations about whether, you know, how right do we have to be now to say that they were wrong before. There's two things everybody agrees on. This is why this is kind of this is an issue that people make a lot. It's all smoke and very little fire. Right. There's two things everybody agree on. Number one, lower courts should be bound by the decisions of the Supreme Court. In the lower courts in the Constitution are referred to as inferior courts. Right. The Supreme Court is called the Supreme Court. That's not just the name it has, it's the function it has. So everybody, except for one guy I know, some who I respect, who dissents on this, there's always got to be one, right?
Yeah.
Usually it's me.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm surprised you're not arguing with yourself right now. But
So everybody believes that lower courts need to be bound by higher courts. This is what's called vertical stare decisis. Mm-hmm. So lower courts should be bound by the higher court, the Supreme Court's decision, even if they disagree with it. Okay.
Yeah.
What's at issue here is what's called horizontal stare decisis. And that is a current Supreme Court bound by a decision of a previous Supreme Court justice. Mm-hmm. And let me just tell you the dirty little secret. There's nobody on the court who has ever been on the court who thinks that the Supreme Court can't reverse its previous precedents.
Right.
Therefore, but everybody agrees lower courts can't do it. Yeah. An inferior court can't reverse the Supreme Court. But everybody believes that today's court can reverse the previous decision of the court. It's been done since the beginning,
right?
And it has been done a lot over the last 100 years. Tremendous numbers of precedents have been reversed over the last 100 years. Yeah. Many of whom, you know, we're very grateful that they reversed. Plessy versus Ferguson was reversed, for example. But some of them we might regret that they were reversed. Anyway, the point here is the only thing we're debating about is when and under what circumstances. So just saying that a decision like Roe or Casey are precedents, and therefore the law of stare decisis says that ordinarily, but for certain circumstances, we ought to follow them, is just stating what everybody believes.
Right.
And then everybody also believes that under certain circumstances, you should not follow them.
Yeah.
And you find that it tends to be the case. And now I'm going to put my legal realist hat on here, which is, you know, sometimes I think when you talk about the Supreme Court, sometimes the right hat to wear,
right.
And that is, this, whether they want to follow previous decisions or not, tends to be up to what the, whether the justices in particular really like those decisions or don't like those decisions. Right. Or the other reason to follow previous decision is you may not like them, but you don't want to open the political can of worms of reconsidering them.
Right.
Think all of the New Deal.
Yeah.
There may be justices who say, well, you know, I have doubts about whether the New Deal expansion of economic regulation was really constitutional, but it's too late in the day for us to reconsider all that. Right. And because the stare decisis, I can't go, you know, you're holding me back, hold me back. Right. I can't go there. But in fact, if they know if they went there, they could blow up the court.
Okay, so let's talk about Clarence Thomas's concurrence, where you know, and what's been getting a lot of attention is, you know, where he said, you know, it's, you know, not only should we have done this with Roe versus Wade, you know, a long time ago, but the rulings that dealt with contraception, sodomy laws, and getting rid of sodomy laws and validating or legitimating gay marriage, those need to be reconsidered as well. You know, what is his argument for that? And should people who believe that the right of married people to buy contraception, you know, that sodomy laws are an affront to, you know, liberty and, you know, that gay marriage should be a national right, you know, should they be concerned?
No, they shouldn't be okay. concerned, but for a lot of reasons, okay. not just one. Yeah. We can get to whether they should be concerned or not. What he's yeah. up to here, first of all, to be technically accurate to what he's doing, to be faithful to what he's doing, he is not claiming that any of those cases were wrongly decided. Mm-hmm. He is not saying by reconsidered, they should be, he means they should be reversed. Mm-hmm. What he says is, these were all cases decided based on substantive due process. I think substantive due process is a lot of hooey.
Yeah.
Therefore, I think that any case that was decided on the basis of substantive due process should be reconsidered. And then he says, and we should see whether perhaps they can be justified under other clauses mm-hmm. of the Constitution. In particular, he mentions the Privileges or Immunities Clause of the 14th Amendment, which he alone on the court so far is interested in reviving. Mm-hmm. Whereas all the other justices are happy to stay within substantive due process. Justice Thomas has long argued, dating back to the McDonald case and earlier, that only this privilege immunities clause protects substantive rights. I think in the case, by the way, of Loving versus Virginia and interracial marriage, the conservative position on this and his position would be, and you know he is himself in an interracial right. marriage, is that this was barred by the Equal Protection Clause mm-hmm. Because it was a racial discrimination, and racial discriminations are per se unconstitutional or largely right. unconstitutional. So that's how he would deal with that. So he is not yeah. saying reverse all of these cases.
But he is also opening up the possibility of, you know, you revisit them and say, you know what, for the same reason that, you know, when the 14th Amendment was, you know, adopted, there wasn't a lot of contraception there, you know, so it's not deeply rooted in American tradition or history. Sodomy was around, but it was illegal, and gay marriage, you know, obviously didn't exist. So it would seem that what he is signaling, plus he, you know, in sodomy cases and gay marriage, he was like, yeah, these, you know, there's nothing wrong with passing laws against these things.
It's complicated.
Okay.
It's because he's not adopting the majority's approach of finding it in history and tradition necessarily, mm-hmm. although he kind of does do that in the gun case. Mm-hmm. So it's complicated.
I'm trying to remember back in 2004, Howard Dean was briefly touted himself, the Vermont governor was running for president, said, I'm the candidate of guns and gays. Because Vermont had pretty liberal gun laws, and it was the first state to sanction gay marriage. Clarence Thomas would say, "I like guns, but gay marriage not so much."
I don't know. Okay. I think if we just stay at the level of what he said yeah. and how threatening it is.
Okay.
He's not saying reverse these cases. That's the first thing.
Okay.
Now, it's true. I think you make a fair point, and it's made by the dissent also. And that is that if you take Justice Thomas's rationale seriously about substantive due process, that and you take away substantive due process, it's not clear that any other theory would be available to uphold
bans, you know, to invalidate bans on contraceptives and things like that. That's a fair response. It's just, he's just not saying it today. He's not making a commitment one way or the other.
Right.
The other, that, so that's number, I'm not saying that's a reason not to be concerned. Yeah. There's another reason.
I mean, he is well known for doing this in other, in dissents in other cases or concurrences, including gun cases, where it's like, hey, maybe we should think about this down the road.
And, yeah.
And it ends that. Up, he ends up, I mean, and this is something Damon Root talks a lot about, and I know you have as well as critics, arch critics of Thomas. He's actually about the most influential member of the Supreme Court in profound ways. So when he, what he says, we should take seriously and look at with care.
He is very influential in part because of what I would, what I have called the gravitational force of originalism. Mm-hmm. And that is that even if the court is not doing originalism, the fact that they have a belief in their head about what originalism requires itself has a gravitational force and pulls them in that direction. Mm-hmm. That's why, because they have a particular view of the due process clause, that mm-hmm. the due process clause is procedural only, they're not doing away with substantive due process, but they think they should limit it. They should limit substantive due process as much as they can, because they have because of the gravitational force of originalism that's exerting a pressure. Justice Thomas articulates the originalist position, even though I think in this case he's wrong.
Right.
But he articulates the originalist position, and therefore there's a gravitational pull towards his position by the others who are not going all the way. But let me get to the why people shouldn't be that concerned at this point.
Okay.
It's not because Justice Thomas's arguments, if taken to a logical conclusion, might not jeopardize these rights, because they might. Mm-hmm. It's because he stands alone on this court as being prepared to do any of that. The other justices made it very, very clear that they're not interested in doing that. And here's the other key. If you think that the court, as being political in somewhat political in nature, and I know you want to get to that later in this discussion, there is just no political impetus to do these things now, as there has been on abortion. That is, abortion is not only different for the reasons that majority says it is, which is it involves the killing of a human.
Or the potentiality of life, right?
Whatever, however you want to characterize it, it makes it different than all these other things.
Right.
But in addition to that, what's different about abortion is there's been a near 50-year political movement to reverse Roe versus Wade that everybody alive today, pretty much everybody alive today, has been a product of or a part of one way or the other.
A witness to, certainly, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And there is no such political impetus to do the things that might be the logical conclusion of what Justice Thomas is saying. So for all practical purposes, and really at some point people are, you know, particularly non-originalists are just trying to be practical. For all practical purposes, I don't believe any of these rights are in jeopardy at this time.
I hope so. But I, you know, what I worry about when I think about that is that according to Gallup, since 1975, when they started polling, only 19%, a maximum of 19%, and basically an average of 19% were opposed to all abortion, which is what, you know, agitates the pro-life movement. So, you know, 80% of Americans basically are in favor of abortion in all or some or most circumstances. Only 70% believe that gay sexual relations are moral, and only about 71% believe in gay marriage. So in a way, there is more of a political constituency against, or rather, you know, there is more, fewer people believe in abortion rights. I'm sorry, I'm messing this up. There is a stronger political, or not political case, but cultural consensus that is kind of dubious about gay relations and gay marriage than there was about abortion.
I don't know that that's still true. The success of the gay rights movement has been astonishing.
Absolutely.
In our lifetime. In
still 30% of people still say gay relations, gay sexual relations are immoral, according to Gallup.
But, you know, this is going to have to manifest itself in state laws that would come under challenge, that the circuit courts of appeal are not going to dispense with. And then the Supreme Court will decide to grant cert and take up that case. All those things have to happen before the court will revisit any cases. Look, it took the court, 12 years to revisit the right to keep and bear arms, a right that they had recognized in 2008 and reaffirmed in 2010. And now it's 2022. It's the first time they've slapped down lower courts' vitiating that right, undermining that right. And that's a right that presumably a majority of them agreed with, and they wouldn't do it. So I just don't think that this is an immediate threat.
Let's talk about guns in a second. Just to close out the discussion of abortion, does the, in your estimation, you know, and we've already seen, you know, about 13 states had trigger laws saying if Roe is overturned, if that the federal right to abortion is overturned, certain laws banning or heavily restricting abortion in those states go into effect. Do you think there will be any limit on banning abortion that the Supreme Court, you know, that a state can put in where a Supreme Court would say, or a higher court would say, you know what, that is, no, that goes too far? Or can states abortion is gone?
I can think of one, and that is life of the mother. Mm-hmm. The Texas abortion law that was invalidated in Roe versus Wade did make an exception for the life of the mother. Mm-hmm. That was the one that was invalidated. And so that, you know, what happened after that was the way the court worded it is life and health of the mother. Right. And that sounds reasonable. But then health became interpreted as mental health.
Right.
And once health was interpreted as mental health or well-being, then that turned into abortion on demand. Mm-hmm. As opposed to life of the mother, which is an exception. So health of the mother became the exception that swallowed the rule. People mm-hmm. inside this debate understand this, mm-hmm. And outside the debate, people don't understand it. But in mm-hmm. so life of the mother, there's a general consensus that when there's a medical emergency that threatens the life of the mother, then abortion is perfectly permissible. Mm-hmm. I'd be surprised if we see any states that deny that, but it could happen. Outlier states could happen. I'd be surprised if lower courts didn't invalidate those laws still. They might not. And we'll have to see how that goes.
Yeah. Are you, do you think this, you know, one of the arguments about Roe and people like Ruth Bader Ginsburg made this when Roe was first pronounced, that it unnecessarily politicized the abortion issue because she was bringing a case that would have pushed for a right to an abortion under different, you know, not under privacy considerations, which went into Roe. But she said, you know, state legislatures were working on this and things were moving ahead, and that Roe unnecessarily politicized the issue. Right wing conservative pro lifers constantly point to that position by Ruth Bader Ginsburg, that, you know, that Roe unnecessarily politicized abortion. Now Roe is gone. Are we going to see an increase in the politicization of the abortion debate, or now that it's back at the state?
Oh, I don't think there's any doubt about that. I think what people that's a certainty.
Yeah.
What nobody knows is which way is that going to cut? Right. Which way are the we've had 50 years with a different kind of a politics over Roe than we're going to now have. Yeah. Nobody knows. This is really uncharted territory. Nobody knows what this kind of politics is going to look like.
We know in the early stages or pre-stages, it's extremely extreme, right? We're seeing a lot of people say abortion is murder, and so we're going to try and ban it under all circumstances. Other people saying because abortion is threatened outside of California and New York, we're going to open up abortion on demand to, you know, its logical conclusion.
And by the way, if people are curious as to why I think life would actually be a recognized exception to any such statutes, and that is because the life of the mother, the right to preserve one's own life, is amongst the most fundamental of the fundamental rights we have and is deeply rooted in the nation's tradition and history. Yeah. So the extent to which a woman has a right to preserve her own life by taking a medical procedure that might cost somebody else a life, but mm-hmm. nevertheless, they have a right to preserve their own life. That's something I think that the courts would have very little difficulty upholding.
Yeah. Final question about abortion. Brett Kavanaugh, in his concurrence, said that states don't have the right to ban travel to get an abortion, like for women seeking to get an abortion. The right of travel is an unenumerated right, or it's recognized as an unenumerated right. Is there any worry? Is there any reason to be worried that states will try to say, no, you can't leave Missouri, you can't leave Mississippi or Texas for the express purpose of getting an abortion?
Here's a fun fact for you. Oh. The only right The only substantive right that the Privileges or Immunities Clause has ever been used to uphold since it was basically negated in 1873 and today is in the 1999 case of Sens v. Roe, where a majority of the court used the Privileges or Immunities Clause to protect the right of interstate travel.
Yeah.
So that right, such as it is now, is not based on the Due Process Clause. It's based on the, at least not entirely on the Due Process Clause. It is also based on the Privileges or Immunities Clause as a fundamental right of citizenship in the United States. And therefore, I think Justice Kavanaugh is on strong grounds in saying that that's a right that needs to be that can be protected by the courts.
Do you?
There is, however, another danger looming there. It's a danger on there's a threat on both sides, and that is it's the threat of a national law passed by Congress on one side of the abortion issue or the other. Either a law recreating a right to abortion using, for example, commerce power, or a right prohibiting or a law prohibiting abortion across the country using Congress's commerce power.
Right.
And that brings up very interesting questions about the limit of the national commerce power. As you know, I was involved in two challenges to laws, the medical marijuana case of Gonzalez versus Raich and NFIB versus Sebelius, in which I argued for a limited scope of the commerce power plus the necessary and proper clause. A lot of progressives were on the other side of that, right, including a majority in both in Raich and a plurality.
And you would guess then if there was a national law passed that said abortion is a right at the national level, liberal justices and certainly liberal activists would cheer that decision. And say, yeah, this is a good use of the commerce clause.
Yeah.
And
if the reverse happens, the question is, would progressives or people who defend abortion rights assert a more limited conception of the commerce power? They weren't prepared to do that when medical marijuana was at issue.
Yeah.
I can tell you that we got no liberal votes,
which is frustrating. And then the frustration on top of that, of course, is that conservatives who normally would expect to say, no, Congress's power under the Commerce Clause is limited. We're like, when it comes to medical marijuana, the federal government gets to dictate the terms.
Right. I think Justice Thomas might actually be a good vote on this, no matter which way the law goes, because he actually questioned, because he's quite strong on this. Will the three progressive justices go along with him? And would there be a fourth Commerce Clause vote? I suspect there might be.
Yeah.
I suspect there might be. We might actually end up making good Commerce Clause law if Congress does either of those two things.
Yeah. Just very quickly, do you have strong feelings personally about abortion? Do you think that abortion should be allowed, that it should be legal under, some, most, or all circumstances?
I've actually never publicly addressed that question, and I'm not going to start today.
Okay. Well, let's talk about guns, because that's, along with the abortion decision, the other major decision, arguably, of this term has to do with the Second Amendment. This is New York State Rifle and Pistol Association versus Bruen, another 6-3 majority decision that essentially ruled that strict limits on public carry of guns violate the Second Amendment. Can you kind of explain the basic message or the basic reasoning of the majority and then evaluate, is this right or wrong?
Well, I think the outcome is clearly right. I have a piece up on SCOTUS blog yesterday, and I will actually excerpt it for the Vala conspiracy, which is on reason.com later today, so that you'll get a link to it there. And in which I argue that I think the outcome of the Gruen case is clearly right. Full disclosure, as I do in my SCOTUS column, I am a concealed carry permit holder in the District of Columbia. And in my column, I talk about all the lengths you have to go and how much money you have to spend and how much time you have to spend to get a concealed carry permit under the DC law, which is a shall issue jurisdiction now because of a court order in 2017. It actually on the books, it's a may issue state like New York had. Let me just say the difference between shall issue and may issue. A shall issue state says if you meet certain requirements that have to be reasonable, any citizen may carry a firearm outside the home. It's carry a concealed firearm outside the home. 43 states, if I accept the court's count, have shall issue. So actually, concealed carry is very, very widespread in the United States now. There are seven residual jurisdictions which have what's called may issue states. And that is basically under those regimes, you have to show a special need that is something other than whatever need the general public has to have a firearm. Mm-hmm. Politically connected people are often able to, quote, show this need, but ordinary people cannot.
This is like famously William F. Buckley, I believe, was able to get a carry permit in New York City, which is very
difficult.
I don't know. Well, I mean, but it's very difficult to do. But, you know, if you know somebody.
Right. I didn't. I've never heard that, but I've heard about a bunch of liberals,
of course,
and anti-gun people who have got them.
Yes.
And I can't. There was some columnist at the Washington Post that famously had one. He even used it,
Carl Rowan. You're talking.
Yeah, Carl
about.
Rowan. Yeah.
And I don't know if that was. I think he was at his home, so I don't know if it. But he, yeah, he shot an intruder.
That was what. That was before Heller, when you couldn't even have one in your home without a special permit. Yeah. Whereas now we could do that.
So, anyway. I mean, so essentially what the argument here is that, you know, and it took decades of centuries for the Supreme Court to rule that the Second Amendment implies an individual right to own guns. And now we're at a point where it says, well, you know, in order to exercise the right of the Second Amendment, you really should be able to carry them. Is that
textually, it's pretty easy. It's pretty simple. If you believe the right to keep and bear arms as an individual right, as a threshold matter, which the Supreme Court has decided, I think correctly, that it is an individual right, then keep guns means have them. Bear guns means carry them.
Right.
And so then the question is, does the right end to keep and carry arms end on your property? Can you not? There's no right to keep and carry arms in public. And the Supreme Court in this case said, no, historically, and as a matter of original meaning, there was no barrier to carrying arms in public outside your home for lawful purposes. And one of those lawful purposes is self-defense.
Yeah.
And so you can carry a gun outside your home for self-defense. Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say again, Brett Kavanaugh, though, in his writing on this decision said, you know, he signaled that the Second Amendment, though, is not an absolute right.
Right. Now, this is the problem I have with Justice Thomas's opinion, mm-hmm. and it's somewhat let's not get to Justice Kavanaugh at this point, but I mean, this is a problem I have with Justice Thomas's opinion. He operates under the assumption, which many do, he's not alone, that if you have a constitutional right, if you establish it's a constitutional right, then it just can't be touched. Mm-hmm. And so once he's established it's a constitutional right, that to carry outside the home, then the question is, can it be touched in any way? And he wants to basically say that it can only be touched if the contours of the right at the time it was recognized in 1791, if the contours of the right included preventing you from carrying it outside the home for this reason or that reason. If it didn't, then you can do it. So we determine whether a regulation or restriction on the right is constitutional by whether it's part of the right itself or it's outside the right, and that's going to be done historically. Mm-hmm. The way I think it's better to think of it, and I talk about this in my SCOTUS blog piece, is you have to distinguish between prohibitions. Mm-hmm. I should just say, this view of rights as being trumps, rights as being super to any conceivable legislation, this is a modern conception of rights. It's a post-New Deal conception of right. It is not our historic conception of how constitutional rights worked. It's better to think of the difference between prohibitions on the one hand and regulations on the other hand. So if you have a constitutional right, the government may not prohibit its exercise. Right.
But it can regulate it.
But it can regulate it.
And so this helps explain, thank you. I think if I'm understanding you correctly, the way that gun rights people talk now, it's that there should be no laws at all limiting, restricting, regulating any ownership of any class of weapon, any ammunition, anything. And when you go back to people like Ronald Reagan, you know, I mean, within our lifetime, you know, the people who were gun rights activists were talking very differently. They were not saying that, you know, gun ownership, you know, the right to keep and bear arms meant that anything goes everywhere.
And I would say virtually no constitutional scholar in the gun rights camp holds the you may not regulate it position. Mm-hmm. So every gun rights. I'm a gun rights scholar.
Right.
And every other gun rights scholar I know believes that all constitutional rights can be reasonably regulated. Mm-hmm. The question is, how do you determine reasonable regulation from not reasonable regulation?
So
you can't just calling it reasonable is not going to get you there.
And you can't. And this is where you go to cases where, you know, if the people passing the law or the legislature says, well, you know, we're doing this because here's a hypothetical. That's not good enough. Right. And if you're talking about kind of strict scrutiny or a legitimate regulation of a constitutional right.
Right. That's one of the ways of arguing why it's not good enough. And the problem here with the Justice Thomas opinion in this case is he's trying to throw out all scrutiny. Mm-hmm. He's against tiers of scrutiny. Well, there's a good reason to be against intermediate, you know, rational basis, intermediate and strict. That might not make sense, but meaningful scrutiny on the one hand is something that might be required by the due process of law, frankly.
So what, you know, what then in terms of, you've already said you're a concealed carry, so anybody listening or watching this will know, don't fuck with Randy Barnett. But what would be, what's an example of a gun regulation that you, as you know, both, I mean, a scholar but also a gun owner, you know, who went through extensive, you know, jumped through extensive hoops to be able to carry in Washington, D.C., which is kind of an insane, you know, jurisdiction for this type of stuff. What's a gun regulation that you think is a good one is plausible from a constitutional
perspective? It's not that hard for me to answer this, having gone through the regime. I had to undergo 16 hours of classroom instruction that covers two things. What is the laws governing gun possession and ownership in D.C.? And secondly, what is the law of self-defense? What is the law of armed self-defense?
Yeah.
Now, I think that before you carry a gun in public, it's as reasonable to expect you to understand what the laws are governing carrying in public as it is to expect you to understand the rules of the road mm-hmm. before you get a driver's license to operate a motor vehicle on a public highway.
Yeah.
You don't need a driver's license to operate a motor vehicle on mm-hmm. private property. But if you're going to go onto a public thoroughfare, you do.
Right.
And then you need to pass a rules of the road test. Mm-hmm. The problem I have with the DC regulation isn't that it making me take this course. Once I took the course, I immediately saw how valuable it was because I didn't know. I'm a law professor. I'm even somebody who's in the gun rights space, and I didn't know all these rules.
Yeah.
And for one thing, they kind of scare the bejesus out of you in terms of carrying because you see all the risks you run. However, did there need to be 16 hours, 2 days worth of instruction to cover this? Absolutely not. This could have been covered in 2 to 3 hours.
Right.
The 16 hours is punitive. The 16 hours is calculated to raise the cost of exercising this right so fewer people will do it. Yeah. Not to mention the fact you have to pay a lot of money to take the course in which they're going to teach you this.
Yeah.
So I think requiring rules of the road. Now, it's not necessary. It's not constitutionally obligatory for states to do this.
Right.
And there are states that have constitutional carry that don't require anything. I just don't think it's unconstitutional to say before you can carry in public, as opposed to on your own property, you need to understand what the law is that's going to govern you when you're in public.
Right.
So I consider that to be a reasonable regulation. It's not telling me I can't do it. It's just telling me if I do it, here's how to do it. And I think when they're telling me how to do it, that has a health and safety rationale that's justified under the police power of the states, which gets us back to what I was saying earlier, that a law needs to be within the legislative power of the states. This would be a health and safety law.
What do you think explains, and I mean this in the best faith possible kind of context, you know, the fact that gun right activists have really gone to the extreme. I mean, the discourse is not about recognizing an individual right to own and bear arms subject to, you know, legitimate regulation. It is, you know, you have no right to ever say anything to restrict anything that I want to do related to weapons. And I guess and it's not just on gun rights. You know, people would argue that that's what happened with abortion. It went from being, you know, a kind of more limited thing to, well, it's got to be abortion on demand, or going the other way. I guess it's a general dynamic where pro-life people might have started, you know, might have said, okay, you know what, like maybe pre-quickening or however we wanted to find that first trimester, that's okay. But then it gets zeroed out to maybe not even the life of the mother. What explains, you know, the kind of move to the extreme position in any given kind of legal or cultural controversy?
Well, in the gun context, I think part of what explains it is extreme skepticism that virtually any gun law that is proposed now is actually being proposed in good faith to genuinely protect the health and safety of the public, as opposed to stigmatizing the exercise of the right or raising the cost of its exercise to the point where people can't do it, or make possible future laws that by which guns can be confiscated and taken away from you. For that's, for example, the argument against registration.
Right.
What do you, you know, to say you have to, I actually, my guns are registered in the, in District of Columbia because they have to be. Right. But you know, say who has any objection to that? That doesn't stop me from having a gun. That seems like a reasonable regulation. All I have to do is have it be registered. Yeah. Except that I understand that there is a large part of the American political activist group that wants to take away all my guns.
Do you feel that way about car registration?
There is no political movement to take away our cars, although there may be a movement to take away internal combustion engine cars, but there is no movement to take away our cars. I think that's a perfect, you raise a perfect example to distinguish the one.
Okay.
Car, the ability to possess a car is not under constant threat. Mm-hmm. The ability to possess a gun is under constant political threat. Therefore, registration makes it possible to take guns. Without registration, you can't find the guns to take them. That's why people would oppose the so-called reasonable regulation of because it makes possible an unreasonable prohibition.
So you could see in a different context where gun registration was not in the context of kind of a movement that's always working to take away guns. You might be like, yeah, I don't care about it. You know, that's fine.
I think a lot of people might feel that way, but that's not the world in which we've lived in since the 1960s,
right,
when the gun control movement started up.
Mm-hmm. And the registration or in the May issue jurisdictions in the country, I mean, one of the things, and I know a number of people, including myself, I'm not particularly interested in gun rights, or, you know, I prefer a broader interpretation of the Second Amendment than a narrow one, but it's not a hot button issue. But one thing that always gets under my skin is when you're talking about May issue places, and oftentimes, you know, the person who wants the permit has to go to law enforcement to get them to say, okay, yeah, we're gonna give you this. And like half the time they're afraid of the law. So it's a kind of ugly situation.
But we're not done with that regime, because California law requires that you be of good moral character.
Yeah.
And it's up to law enforcement to assess whether you are or not. And I think I can expect that all the other May issue states, like New York, for example, are going to start issuing those kinds of ways of restricting people to own guns. And that's not quite the same as saying you have to have a specialized need that the public doesn't have. This sounds more like, you know, are you a law-abiding American? But on the other hand, if you're saying, are you a moral, and they're basically looking at statements that you've made and, you know, times you may have been arrested but never convicted. This is actually the regime in California now.
Yeah.
So I think we can expect those laws to come under challenge.
Why did it take so long for the Supreme Court to recognize an individual right to possess and, you know, to own and bear arms?
The answer to this is a big picture answer about how the Supreme Court gets chosen over time. And that is the Supreme Court that is composed. And this actually gets to a question that you said you wanted to get into, which was the Mark Tushnet question about how much does the Supreme Court lead or follow the general public. The Supreme Court has many virtues. I'm a big fan of having a Supreme Court that's independent of the other branches. Mm-hmm. But remember, Supreme Court justices are nominated by a politically elected president, and they can only nominate people that they think are going to get confirmed by a politically elected Senate. Now, just having just said that, don't you see how there's got to be kind of a limit on who is ever going to, a political limit, on who's ever going to get to sit on the Supreme Court in the first place, apart from all the other restrictions that would stop someone from sitting there. And so that's going to like eliminate the extremes even if the extreme is correct.
Yeah.
So if you think that it's an extreme view of the Second Amendment that it protects an individual right and that these gun laws are unconstitutional and judges should be invalidating them, if you think that's an extreme view, as, for example, Chief Justice Warren Burger, who was nominated to be Chief Justice by Richard Nixon, thought. He thought this was a theory that was a conspiracy or fraud perpetrated on the public by the NRA. That's what Warren Burger thought. Well, if you have justices picked from that cultural milieu, that's how they're going to approach this question. And it took until now for the gun rights movement to have enough, to exert enough influence over enough presidents and enough senators before to get a critical mass of justices who were prepared to enforce the original meaning of the Constitution. And that's, by the way, the last piece of this, and that is that a return to originalism is one of the things that helped gun rights, because it said courts should not be just making things up, and courts should not just be doing what they think is right. They should do what the text says is right. And the text looks like there's a right to bear arms.
Yeah, it's. I remember from an earlier interview with you years ago, but you were talking about how kind of when you were in law school, and I mean, it's kind of insane, and you've written a lot about the triumph of originalism, but lawyers and judges didn't really look at the text of the law a lot, which is kind of mind-numbing that it's taken this long.
It's a little disturbing to me that you remember what I said in our interviews over the years.
Yeah, well, I'm a textualist. I don't know if I want
to stand by absolutely everything.
I get that, certainly. But were there no cases in the 19th century? I mean, or when the first rules, laws regulating the ownership of guns started to come online, and these were, specifically geared, state level geared at blacks. Later, I guess in New York City and other places, that when they enacted gun control, it was explicitly geared towards my ancestors from Italy, people who, supposedly had bad impulse control.
Understandably.
Steeped in the vendetta, that I still live by. Were there no challenges to that, that made it to the Supreme Court to be like, no, actually, like, an individual right to own and bear guns that actually also covers blacks and Italians?
Well, what motivated the Privileges or Immunities Clause in the 14th Amendment in part was the fact that African-Americans who had, especially those who had served in the Union Army, were having their guns taken away from them in the South, where white militiamen were allowed to keep them. That's, by the way, one of the arguments for why there's not a militia condition on the 14th Amendment. The militia was the problem for which the 14th Amendment was the answer. So the idea that those laws are unconstitutional go all the way back. On the other hand, the Supreme Court then gutted the Privileges or Immunities Clause from the 14th Amendment, leaving all of those Privileges or Immunities Clause vulnerable to state legislation until the rise of modern substantive due process, which started to bring back the protection of some of the rights that had been protected by the Privileges and Immunities Clause originally. So that's part of the answer to your story, to your question. The other answer to your question is that almost all the earlier gun laws that we had until the 1960s movement to ban handguns, which was the big movement in the 1960s, and they started talking about Saturday night specials, for example. Almost all the gun laws that came before that, I think, were reasonable regulations. That is, they may not have been great policy. They may have been, you may have been better policies, but they were not prohibited policies.
Right.
And so there wasn't really a serious constitutional problem with virtually any of the gun laws that operated prior to the rise of the gun ban or the gun prohibition movement beginning in the 1960s.
That raises an interesting question that I wanted to ask about gun laws in particular. One of the ways over the past, 25, 30 years at the state level, there were, massive liberalizations of gun ownership laws. It became easier to own and kind of possess guns in a wider range of circumstances. Part of the selling point of that was that at the same time guns were becoming easier to own, gun violence was going down. In the same way that you're talking about in the 60s, there was a lot of, there was urban, a massive spike in crime, particularly in cities. There were high profile political assassinations with guns. That led to a flurry of legislative activity. What we are witnessing now after decades of a decline in violent crime, we're starting to see an uptick. It's still well below what it was in the 70s or even in the mid 90s. But do you worry? Excuse me?
just wait.
Yeah. Well, do you worry, you know, and on the heels of, you know, a number of highly publicized school shootings, do you worry? And actually, I guess Congress just passed legislation, right, limiting certain types of gun rights, bipartisan. Do you worry that an increasing gun crime or gun violence will force a reconsideration of Second Amendment rights?
I think it's going to be used for that end, and it always has been used for that end. But let me just suggest that there are two problems here. One is that almost all gun control people want to aim their attention solely at innocent, law-abiding gun owners. Mm-hmm. That's who they want to restrict. That's who they want to take guns away from. They are actually not all that in favor of enforcing the existing gun laws that we have against people who violate gun laws, mm-hmm. because in fact, they will argue that these have racially disparate impacts on certain mm-hmm. communities. There are places in which gun prosecutions by progressive prosecutors are not taking place. People mm-hmm. are given bail or no bail. They're just sent back out into the streets. That mere possession of illegal possession of a gun, let's say, is not going to be punished. And so we have a problem when punishing a gun crime is being ameliorated. That is, we're not yeah. punishing gun crimes, but what we are prepared to do is take guns away from people who want to protect themselves
right.
from gun crimes.
And who are playing by the rules. I mean, by the rules. Yeah.
And who, in the case of concealed carry permits in shall issue states like mine, have to pass a background check myself before I'm allowed to conceal carry.
Let's talk about the other kind of major cases. Maybe we can talk about have to do with religion and public school or K through 12 education, not necessarily public school. There were two cases decided this term. One had to do with a football coach who would volunteer, he would pray on the 50-yard line. Randy, as I don't know how familiar you are with the New Testament, but, you know, Jesus spends a not insignificant amount of time kind of bitching about people who pray on the street corner so that people might see them rather than actually, you know, have an indwelling of the Spirit.
Well, I'm strictly an Old Testament guy.
I was assuming as much. So you have a football coach who is praying on the 50-yard line after football games. I guess I don't know if he prays after victories or only losses. But and he would ask his players voluntarily, by most accounts, like, you know, do you want to pray with me? That was ruled not to be problematic. And then in a case involving a Maine tuition program for rural students, there was a tuition program that they had started, which would allow students to use that money to go to religious schools or public schools or private schools. And that was also seen as kosher, if I could mix Abrahamic metaphors here. Where do we stand at the end of this term in terms of kind of religious freedom or educational freedom?
I think as a general rule, or as a general matter with this court and this composition is very interested in protecting the free exercise of religion, especially when it looks like religious observances are being discriminated against mm-hmm. in favor of other kinds of things. And this right. is what we even saw during COVID. The only types of COVID regulations that the courts were prepared to invalidate were those which seemed to discriminate against gatherings for religious purposes mm-hmm. while allowing gatherings right. for other purposes. So free exercise is of great interest to this court.
Yeah.
At the same time, there has been a very severe scale back on what they think the scope of the Establishment Clause is. For many years, it's been thought that the Establishment Clause and the Free Exercise Clause kind of clash, because to the extent government allows free exercise, they then could be turned around and being accused of establishing a religion right. or promoting religion. This clash, I think, is overstated. And what the Supreme Court is doing is they're pulling back on their Establishment Clause, saying in the case of school vouchers, it is not an establishment of religion. If you have a voucher scheme for other schools, it's not against establishment of religion to also include religious schools. In fact, it violates free exercise to discriminate against religious schools if you have a general scheme like that. That's what you're seeing. And I think you're going to see.
And from a libertarian perspective, that's good, right? I mean, it expands the scope of individual choice making.
Yeah, I think that we would like to see alternatives to government schools set up. And part of that is to, and this is what Arizona, I guess, is poised to pass, if they haven't passed it already, a system in which the money follows the student, that students can take the $7,000 or whatever the state is paying towards education to whatever school they wish to take it to. Of course, there's issues arising by which schools are serious schools.
Yes.
But in principle, yeah. So I think, yes, this is an enumerated right that the conservatives on the court, the free exercise clause is enumerated right, the free exercise of religion conservative justices are prepared to protect. And they don't think that the establishment clause is implicated very often when they do.
Right.
And let me just throw this one thing out. This is not something I have reached a conclusion about, but I am skeptical that the establishment clause was a privilege or immunity, it involved a privilege or immunity of citizenship that would have been protected by state law under the 14th Amendment. When Jacob Howard introduced the 14th Amendment into Senate, he was a senator, he was the sponsor of the bill in the Senate, and he listed all the rights that he said were privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States. He first of all talked about unenumerated rights. And then after that, he turned to the ones that are in the Constitution. He left off the Establishment Clause. And I think the reason might be that it wasn't an individual right at all. The Establishment Clause is a restriction on Congress's power and the national power to establish a national religion. It isn't an individual right. The Privilege or Immunities Clause protects individual rights. That isn't one. If that's true, and the Supreme Court hasn't said that it's true, and I don't think they will in any way like the near future, if that's true, it means that there really is no establishment restrictions on states at all.
And that would mean that
free exercise clause would have to be doing all the work.
And there is, another decision that was made, Shurtleff v. Boston, 9-0, kind of rare, actually, that kind of unanimous decision, saying that it was wrong for the city of Boston to fly a Christian flag when it was flying a bunch of other kind of special interest flags.
Right.
So, it does seem.
Notice the discrimination part of that claim.
Right. Yeah,
you're going to see that often. It's going to be an anti-discrimination against religion claim. And that is founded in, for example, Justice Kennedy's views in a previous case. I won't name the case, but it was the Church of Lukumi Babalu'i. That's the name of the case. It's hard against the city of Hialeah. He said laws have to be general and neutral.
Right.
And what they're finding is that they think these laws are not general and neutral. That means they're discriminating against religion.
Right. And it seems at this point, religion has less force in life than it did certainly 30 years ago or 40 years ago.
There's an argument that what we're seeing in large part from the left is a religious movement. Mm-hmm. It doesn't involve a deity like the gods at the theistic movement. It's not a theist religion, but there's all kinds of religious aspects to the political correctness that we have to hew to or be condemned as heretics or blasphemous, blasphemes if we say the wrong words. And so I'm not sure that religiosity has been reduced in this country, but I mean, we may be seeing a rise of an alternative religiosity.
Sure,
to replace
organized religion. I mean, we're talking about mainline Protestant and Catholic denominations, things like that seem to. Let's talk a little bit about.
What did I just agree to? I said correct. Yeah, I mean,
what I said was, the religious right is not as powerful as it was in 1985.
Oh, I don't know.
Organized religion does not play the same role.
Yeah, I'm not going to say yes or no to that question. I just don't know.
Can we talk about, at the end of this term, which also is the end of Stephen Breyer's, run as a Supreme Court justice, how would you summarize what the Roberts Court is up to? And does it even make sense to talk about it as the Roberts Court? I mean, even though he's the Chief Justice.
Well, they're probably eventually going to talk about the early robbers court when he was the swing vote, mm-hmm. and the later robbers court when he's the sixth vote, because I think it's a different court. These last few days should have taught us that a Roberts court in which there's a 6-3 conservative majority, and Chief Justice Roberts is a conservative. I'm a big critic of his, but I certainly believe he's a conservative. Mm-hmm. With a 6-3 conservative majority is a different kind of a court than with a 5-3 conservative majority of some kind. We have now, with the addition of Justice Barrett, mm-hmm. Entered a new era, and we are now in the last 5 days starting to realize or starting to begin to see what that era is going to look like. And we don't know, but you know, we have the data point now,
yeah,
and then we're going to see where this is going to go.
From a libertarian perspective, are you optimistic that this is going to lead to a restriction in, you know, the government, the size, scope, and spending of government, or in an increase in individual rights and liberty? How would you, you know, we have a few weeks of data here, prognosticate.
Well, one of the things we got from Justice Kennedy when he was the swing vote was kind of a libertarian policy outcome driven court, because Justice Kennedy did seem to favor individual mm-hmm. liberty in a variety of ways, regardless of how that related to the Constitution. Yep. And so with him as the swing vote, sometimes he'd vote with the conservatives and sometimes mm-hmm. he'd vote with the progressives. And we had what you could say generally on a policy grounds, libertarian friendly outcomes. Right. He's gone. We have a different court now with different people who are swings. We don't know how they're going to work. Now, a libertarian needs to think about how much do they like the original Constitution, mm-hmm. And how much do they think adhering to the original Constitution on balance is a good thing for liberty, even if it doesn't mean they get all the results they want from a particular judicial ruling.
Right.
So, for example, regardless of which side of the abortion question you're on, the outcome of Dobbs is at least supposed to be that this issue is going to be returned to state legislatures mm-hmm. in which you would get 50 state solutions.
Right.
I mean, during COVID, we did have federalism operating. There were 50 state solutions. Mm-hmm. And I ended up, moving to Florida. Where I am now a resident of the state of Florida,
yeah.
Because their policies were different than the policies in the District of Columbia.
Yeah.
This
is a fascinating question, because, decentralization or dispersion of power, federalism, part of that is a process. It's a discovery process, because different states will do different things. And that might be good for individual liberty, but it also can be really bad for individual liberty,
yeah.
depending and on what the results are.
Right. And I think that's the reason why there is no, quote, libertarian view of this, other than to think that the original scheme in the Constitution as modified by the 14th Amendment and other amendments constraining state power so that states may not violate the rights of their own citizens, which is what the 14th Amendment stops you from doing, that this is actually on balance good for liberty. Or what the court has referred to as ordered liberty, mm-hmm. because ordered liberty is not unlimited license to do whatever you feel like. It means you're constrained by the rights of others. And it is the government's responsibility to protect the rights of others. And then the question is, do we want that done on a one size fits all basis at the federal level? Mm-hmm. Or do we want 50 state approaches to this where people not only can vote with their ballots, but like me, they can vote with their feet and they can live in an area where they feel more comfortable. I live in Central Virginia as well as Florida. I feel very comfortable in Central Virginia. I don't feel as comfortable in DC mm-hmm. because of the other kind of progressives that are there. Where can you feel most comfortable? And 50 states of federalism allows you to make that choice.
But there are limits on that, right? And this might be a good point to ask you about. You're a critic of majoritarianism, and you've written considerably about the concept of judicial engagement, which you say it's not the same thing as judicial activism, whether it's coming from a liberal or a conservative or a libertarian position. Can you explain judicial engagement? And then do you think this court is going to be strong on that concept of judicial engagement in the way that you would prefer to see?
I don't think so. I mean, this is, you know, I'm within the originalism movement, and that puts me within the conservative legal movement, even though I'm a libertarian. It's part of a broader coalition. We've won some intellectual victories within that movement. The one in particular is to follow the text of the Constitution, which is good.
Yeah.
But we haven't won at all. And for example, the unenumerated rights issue is we haven't won that issue within the conservative legal movement. And so I think even all of the young judges that have been put on the courts of appeals during the Trump administration, who are really, really good on originalism, are not necessarily really, really good on judicial engagement to protect mm-hmm. other liberties that we may have. And so I think it's a mixed bag. I prefer this regime. I prefer this regime mm-hmm. to the regime that where originalism did not have a role to play. Mm-hmm. You referred back to something I said about when I was a law student, taking Larry Tribe for my con law class. I basically was, you know, following along in the case book, and I would get to a part of the Constitution that I thought was really good, like the Ninth Amendment. Then I turned the page of the case book and I would see the court said, well, that doesn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. Oh, and the commerce power, well, that's unlimited. And the right to keep and bear arms, well, there isn't one of those. Mm-hmm. And I would go to all these pages. And by the time I was done with the course, I was done with the Constitution.
Yeah.
And I went on to be a criminal prosecutor, which is what I went to law school to be, a criminal lawyer. And then I became a contracts professor, because what was the point of the Constitution? The court was going to ignore it. Mm-hmm. Well, the court doesn't really ignore it anymore. Now we have to fight about what it means. That's different than the fight about whether we should care what it means or not.
Right.
And that's the fight we're in now. I think we're ahead, but by no means am I going to get everything I want. I mean, I'll give you the perfect example on the ground, and I've already mentioned it. It's COVID. Mm-hmm. Under COVID, the only right or liberty that the judicial system as a whole was prepared to protect was the liberty to free exercise of religion. Mm-hmm. I'm for that.
Yeah.
But there were other liberties, like the right to pursue a lawful occupation, the one mm-hmm. that Damon writes about, that they were not at all interested in protecting. And so we had all these shutdowns. Mm-hmm. I have a complicated view about the constitutionality of that. But the point is that the judiciary was completely uninterested. The conservatives,
right,
justices, judges, lower court judges, were completely uninterested in protecting us from an abusive COVID regime. I think that's indicative of where they are and where they're going to continue to be.
Yeah. So that might be one of the big distinctions, really, legally in the legal profession, but also beyond that, between conservatives and libertarians.
Yeah. I mean, let me just say, it goes back to what we started with, the due process of law. Mm-hmm. If you think the due process of law is satisfied, if you have a fair trial, and the law that is being used to prosecute you was passed by the requisite majority of both houses and signed into law by the governor or the president, if you think that's all the due process of law requires, which I think many conservatives do, mm-hmm. that's not good enough. The due process of law also requires that the law be within the proper power of the legislature to enact. And that requires it to be within an enumerated power of Congress. Conservatives will go along with that. And also within the police power of the states, there needs to be a limited conception of what the police power of states are. It can't mean everything, because everything is tyrannical.
Right.
And so that's where the action is. That's something we don't have. We have not achieved victory about. We have. I'm in the small minority in the conservative legal movement on that position right there. And it's where I disagree with Justice Thomas and what he says about the due process clause.
You know, one of the outcomes of the past couple of weeks has, people like Senator Elizabeth Warren, Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, in the wake of the Dobbs decision about abortion, said this court is illegitimate. We have, you know, certainly over the past 50 years.
But it sounds very insurrection-y to me.
It is. It's extremely. And what I was going to say is, over the past 50 years, we have seen a massive decline in trust and confidence in governmental institutions, both if you just ask people about government in general, but then when you break it down into, you know, the presidency, the House, the Congress, et cetera. The Supreme Court also, in 1981, according to Gallup, fully 46% had a great deal of confidence or a lot of confidence in the Supreme Court. Only 13% had very little confidence. You move forward now to 2021, and it's only 36% have a great deal of confidence or a lot of confidence in the Supreme Court. 21% have very little. Is the court becoming, you know, do you agree or do you find that the court is deemed less legitimate than it used to be? And if so, or regardless, I guess, is that a big problem when the Supreme Court loses its sense of legitimacy among the American people?
Well, I mean, I don't have a lot of confidence in the court. So, yeah. And I believe in the court. So,
right.
I don't know how I would come out on that survey. I think these surveys are sketchy, right?
Okay.
I believe in an independent judiciary. I'm against court packing. I testified in front of the Presidential Commission on the Supreme Court against court packing. Mm-hmm. And I even argued that it was unconstitutional, which has put me on the outer fringes there. So I support the court, but I don't necessarily have a high degree of confidence. Yep. In them, because I said I was I was so disappointed in the Supreme Court as a law student in the late 70s that I gave up on the Constitution altogether. So I've come back. I have more confidence now than I did then, mm-hmm. but that still puts me below 50% of confidence.
Right.
I do think it's important that people respect the authority of the court. And I think most people do. I mean, the people that are excited on both sides are people that are really focused on these things.
Yeah.
They're the activist class. Most generally people, you know, the people that were just working here around my yard, putting mulch, we had new mulch, being shoveled out as I've been talking to you. I'm sure they have as much respect for the Supreme Court as they ever had. And I assume that it's pretty high.
Yeah.
And they just don't follow every twist and turn this way. I think it's really dangerous, however, that people who don't like the Supreme Court, how they're ruling now, but love the Supreme Court when they were ruling for them.
Right.
They love judicial supremacy, even when they had the power, and now hate it and think it's illegitimate. I think there's a big problem with people like that.
Yeah.
Undermining, working to undermine the legitimacy of
an institution. Is there anything the court can do to inspire more confidence among, you know, kind of activist people? Or is that just kind of a lost cause?
Well, I can tell you one thing that they shouldn't do, and that is to try to pursue legitimacy by doing what the activist people want them to do. Mm-hmm. I think that is a recipe for illegitimacy. I think what Justice Roberts did Chief Justice Roberts did in the healthcare case, where he was viewed as succumbing to pressure being brought to bear on him after oral argument. Mm-hmm. I think that to the extent that that is what people perceived him as having done, bent
yeah.
to political opposition, undermine the legitimacy of the court and in the course of trying to pursue the preservation of the legitimacy of the court. So I think that's a big mistake. I just think they just need to do their job.
Right. What do you think about the leak of Alito's opinion, of the draft opinion, which I guess there's an investigation going on, but we haven't heard anything about who done it. Do you think that, I mean, is it a bad thing that these drafts get leaked? And then is it will it become more of an issue depending on who leaked it for, you know, what ends?
Well, it's absolutely a terrible thing. They need to be able to deliberate with each other and to exchange drafts mm-hmm. without having a leak that was designed to bring public pressure to bear on how they're going to rule before they actually rule. Remember that, plus the threats to their physical safety mm-hmm. Were being made against justices who had not yet ruled. Until the ruling was announced on Friday, it wasn't official.
Yeah.
It didn't matter what the vote was. It didn't matter what the opinions read. Until they announced it to the public, they could always change their vote. And if one of the justices had been assassinated, and we had that would have changed the outcome of the case. It would have been it would have been a 4-4 case. Mm-hmm. Or it'd have been I don't know what Chief Justice Roberts would have done. But it could have changed the outcome of the case. This is horrible. This is terrible. It should be condemned in no uncertain terms, and it hasn't been condemned in no uncertain terms. We have an administration who has wink-nodded at this kind of pressure being put on a court that is not supposed to be responding to this kind of action in the streets.
You know, it's kind of in the background, but the attorney general is Merrick Garland, who was put up as a Supreme Court judge, or was going to be nominated by Barack Obama.
He was nominated.
Oh, he was nominated, but there was never a confirmation hearing,
right.
Partly because of Mitch McConnell, you know, kind of working various Senate kind of processes, which are legitimate or, you know, which are lawful, but, you know, are kind of sketchy, I think. Is it, does that kind of machination lead to a politicization or a drain of confidence in the court, not giving presidents their, you know, their shot at confirming?
Well, there has been a downward spiral in the judicial nominations process that goes back at least as far as Robert Bork.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it might have gone back farther.
Yeah.
And everybody, both sides have a narrative they want to push about how it's the other side's fault. I think I know whose fault it is. I think it is the other side's fault, whoever mm-hmm. the other side of me is, right? I think it's their fault. But nevertheless, this is nothing new, and it's not good. And every move that other side makes seems to be get another move as we go into a downward spiral. That is part of the polarized area in which we live. Let me pull back. There's a bigger picture that you need to see here, I think, Nick, and that is that as long as there was an overall consensus amongst Republicans and Democrats, what we might call the post-New Deal consensus about what the role of the courts were, then the judicial nominations process could be conducted solely on the basis of what you might call qualifications or how smart you are, where you went to school, how good a lawyer you were, what's your judicial temperament going to be? Do you seem to be corrupt because you're in the pocket of somebody? You didn't have to think about how to interpret the Constitution as part of that because everybody kind of agreed. But what happened was we had an intellectual movement, which is called the conservative legal movement. It was part of the overall rise of the conservative movement, of which libertarians were a part, whether they like it or not. And as a result of that conservative legal movement, challenging the way the courts were interpreting the Constitution at a fundamental level, this is the originalism versus non-originalism challenge. As when that started happening, it made the selection of judges political. Because one party started to align with one approach, the other party started to align with the other approach, and each party started to try to advance their side by the political means at their disposal, political presidents nominating, a political Senate approving. And so it is the polarization of the parties, which I think is actually beneficial, because we have one side that I think is more right than the other side about how the Constitution should be interpreted. It's the polarization of the parties that's led to the polarization of the process. And so it's unavoidable. It's unavoidable. And the only way it'll ever be resolved is if there's any kind of new consensus that's reached that will then cause that to fall out, and we can just focus on how smart you are, where you went to school, and what your experience was.
Do you have what might be the type of event or process that would lead to that building of a new consensus?
I really don't know. It's a good question. It's a fair question. I would like to think, for example, that if progressives find that they have lost their ability to command a national majority of the kind that they can ram a one size fits all solution down our throats. And conservatives seem poised to be able to do that. Conservative Republicans seem poised to be able to do that at the national level, that in fact, progressives could rethink their opposition to federalism and rethink their opposition to limits on national power and join forces with those of us who are already there to preserve our federalism that the Constitution makes that limited federal powers makes possible. Mm-hmm. So I would think it's political defeats of a certain kind as opposed to political successes that might give rise to people moving intellectually. But, you know, this is could be like a Kuhnian paradigm analysis where, you know, things don't change until a new generation comes along because the previous generation just has their priors just too firmly embedded within their brain.
And it could be that conservatives now are sensing, you know, they have a 6-3, you know, Supreme Court majority, which is not going anywhere, and they're about to win big in the midterms. They might start feeling really flush with success. And,
well, we've seen this is another segment. This is another show we can do. We've seen the rise of so-called common good constitutionalism on the right from people like Harvard professor Adrian Vermeule and others, who are arguing to jettison originalism and just go for conservative results. Now, and he said it quite nakedly. He cites in his Atlantic article, which he announces this position publicly, his book is different, but in the Atlantic piece, he cites Tushnet's article against defensive crouch of liberalism and says, now we have the court. Right. We should do what Tushnet said the progressives should do. And it turns out they didn't get the court.
Right.
So you're going to see this on the right. And the people who are going to be squeezed in the middle are people like me, who believe in following the Constitution, the original meaning of the Constitution, where it leads to conservative results, and also where it leads to liberal or progressive results. And maybe when they see this threat from the right, as I think some progressives maybe are starting to feel like, maybe they have more to fear from a conservative court than from an originalist conservative court.
Right.
That maybe you think you don't like conservative originalism, how would you really like conservative non-originalism?
Yeah.
That might get people towards an originalist view in the middle.
Because that conservative non-originalism, it's majoritarianism run rampant.
Well, it's or it's whatever the courts decide to do. It's the Warren court only of the right.
Yeah.
Is that what you want?
No, I certainly don't. But
not you.
About that generational question, there's been a lot of talk about, you know, the right left kind of splits on the court and kind of, you know, conservative justices, having a commanding majority. I at least try to push this because I was raised Catholic. You know, there's a lot of people on the Supreme Court, which was once famously antagonistic towards Catholics. You know, it's everybody on the court practically was raised or is a Catholic. But there's a generational issue. How important is it that, you know, the people who are, I guess, you know, under 60 or under 55, are they, regardless of where they end up, you know, ideologically, are they of a common mind in a way that we should be taking seriously and starting to map out what that means for the Supreme Court?
Well, I know a lot of the judges that were put on the bench during the Trump administration, they're all young. I mean, compared to me, they're really young. In fact, when I'm in a room full of Court of Appeals judges, I feel like I'm teaching a law school class because I'm so much older. I'm the oldest person in the room by a lot.
How old are you?
I'm 70. I turned 70 this year. So so it's like remarkable to see these bright young judges who I very much like. So you have to think about, well, what's their mindset? And when I was talking earlier about where we've come and where we haven't come, that's who I was talking about. I wasn't so much talking about the justices. I was talking about the lower court judges. We have, you know, in terms of judicial engagement, you know, we have judges who are prepared to be engaged in enforcing the original meaning of the text of the Constitution as they understand it. They may be wrong in their understanding, but that's how they are still not with us on the role that unenumerated rights should play in doing that.
Right.
And so they're still looking for, they're still skeptics on the Ninth Amendment. They're skeptics on the Privileges or Immunities Clause because that's not in their DNA. Mm-hmm. So half of the battle has been won with them or a part of them, and the other part hasn't been. And I don't expect them to change. They're young. But I still don't expect them. They're still old enough to be Court of Appeals judges. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they're like in their 40s or 50s. Yeah. I don't expect them to change their minds. And so that's the mindset that we're going to have to be dealing with for decades to come.
In the next Supreme Court session, Ketanji Brown Jackson will be on the court. Will she, I believe when she was confirmed, you wrote about how she and a couple of liberal judges or Democratic judges, you know, actually are in the originalist camp now, even if they don't talk about it in those terms, because they look at the text and the meaning of it at the time of adoption of laws or amendments.
Well, it's close. I made the opposite point.
Okay, so it's very close. It's just diametrically wrong. So,
yeah, but it was actually knowingly very close. And that is that I said before she was she was confirmed. It was actually the week she testified. Is that she talked originalism, that the position that when repeatedly asked about her approach to constitutional interpretation, she not only voiced the originalist position, but she had voiced the public meaning originalist position to which I adhere amongst all the other competing originalist views. And not only did she do it repeatedly, but she did it obviously having been prepared to do it. I'm not saying it's not her own views, but I'm saying that she obviously, when the White House was prepping her and they have murder boards and all the rest, that obviously they did this. They were prepping her on this question, and the White House counsel's office was fine, was okay with her basically asserting that she was an originalist when it came to the text of the Constitution. So that was remarkable. I thought sociologically that was huge. Yeah. What I didn't claim, although I was accused of having been naive about this, I didn't necessarily claim that she would be actually be an originalist when she's on the bench.
Right.
I don't know what she's going to do, but I don't have any great confidence in that. I mean, I don't think some of the conservative originalists are always originalists on the bench either, for that matter. I mean, Justice Alito, who I respect enormously, has never written, unless you consider the Dobbs opinion to be an originalist opinion, which some people do, and it may be closer to one than I originally thought. Mm-hmm. He's never written an originalist opinion before. He's always written a doctrinalist opinion that came out in the conservative way. And I think his opinions are really worth studying, and they're persuasive in many cases, but he hasn't. It's Justice Thomas who's been doing originalist opinions, and Justice Scalia before him. So, or at the same time. So I don't know what she's going to do on the court. I thought what was significant historically is that after 30 years of no Republican judge being willing to call themselves an originalist or identify that, now we have a young progressive judge who is basically defending herself by asserting originalism. That was significant. Yeah. It means that we in the originalist movement have been winning that argument.
That's two final points or questions. One, Ilya Shapiro was going to join you at Georgetown Law because of a tweet having to do with Ketanji Brown Jackson. He's not coming to Georgetown Law. How do you feel about the way that his case was handled and his ultimate decision not to join the faculty?
Well, it was a travesty, which I have been intimately living with every day since it happened in January or February. His original start date, I think, was supposed to be February 1st. And so I've been living with this issue. I mean, I've only been free of this issue now for the last couple of weeks. Otherwise, I've lost a lot of sleep about it because I thought he was being treated quite unfairly by my dean, who I actually am beholden to. I wouldn't have a Center for the Constitution were it not for my dean. And he's very supportive of me. And yet I thought he didn't act correctly in this good circumstance. And he knows I think that. And I thought that, but what was even worse was the administration, which decided to engage in a 4-month investigation to yield the conclusion that they had no jurisdiction because the tweet happened before he joined the faculty. Before he joined the school.
Yep.
They could have figured that out in a week, I think, or it didn't take them 4 months to figure it out. They were clearly waiting, I think, for the students to leave campus before they announced this decision. But even more long-term consequences to me is that the reasoning of the investigation committee was such that it meant that if you say something offensive to enough students or members of the community, then that offensiveness will override Georgetown's protection of freedom of speech, even though the protection of freedom of speech we have expressly says that we should be free to say things that others find offensive. The HR or non-discrimination overlay of that has essentially gutted our free speech protections. I no longer have the same free speech protections at Georgetown that I once had as a result of the way they adjudicated his case. And that's the reason why he quit, because he knew that they basically had issued an opinion that was a slow motion firing of him. that all he had to do was say one more thing that caused people to have offense, and they already announced in advance that that would be enough. Mm-hmm. And so why stick around for that to happen? When the one more thing happens, that's not going to be any fun. So quit now. Well, the one more before the one more thing has happened, and get a better job, which is what he did. He's at the Manhattan Institute, right, which is a much better place for him to be than at Georgetown. But I'm still at Georgetown. And so that makes me concerned.
Yeah. Do you feel a serious chilling effect, or does it actually embolden you to speak your mind more?
There has always been a chilling effect. If you're on the right in academia, if you're deemed to be on the right. And so I've always had to speak with that in mind. And of course, it's gotten much worse. So yes, I guess I do feel a chilling effect. And I don't, but on the other hand, I don't know that it's going to affect anything. I don't think I will fail to say anything that I didn't formally say, mm-hmm, but it's not as though I don't censor myself a little bit anyway. I mean, it's the reason why Twitter is bad for people, because Twitter lets their inner id out. And sometimes we don't want to know what's in their inner id. In fact, most of the time, I think we don't want to know that. And so, you know, like everybody else in the public domain, I try to take care about how I present myself publicly. So there's always a bit of censorship that's going, self-censorship that's going on. But now I just think that, let's put it this way. Under my new arrangement with Georgetown, I no longer have to teach a required class. Mm-hmm. I teach electives only. If they told me I wouldn't be allowed to teach a required class, I would object to that. But I chose basically to teach electives only. And partly that makes me feel more comfortable, because if I have students in my class who didn't choose to take me, they may be more likely to be gunning for me. And then the administration gives them a way to do that.
Right.
Whereas if they're all people who have chosen to take me, it's either because they already kind of agree with me, although they may be surprised, or they just want to hear an opposing view. And many students are like that. And they also are surprised. And so I still feel I can be comfortable in my teaching, primarily because I'm not teaching a required class anymore.
Do you feel, you've been teaching, law for decades now. Do you feel, is there a significant shift away? Are students more open-minded or more curious than they used to be? Are they more activist and more, kind of draconian and wanting to block or shut down speech or ideas that they don't approve of?
I think it's wrong to speak of all students, mm-hmm, because there's students that fall into at least two categories: those who are just like they always were, who come to law school to learn and are open to being challenged, mm-hmm, and view that as kind of exciting, and those that now want to engage in political correctness, which is almost tame, but now it's been escalated to the cancel culture. Right. They want to engage in the cancel culture. And I've had to do battle with that segment of the Georgetown community for several years now. I've had three different, in addition to the Ilya Shapiro incident, there was an incident I became involved with when Justice Scalia died and the dean issued a press release, the headline of which was "Georgetown mourns the loss of Justice Scalia." Well, that gave rise to a huge outcry amongst some of our students. And I came to the defense of our conservative students, who I thought were being put upon in social media and other places because of that. And then the second one is when, my Center for the Constitution invited Jeff Sessions to give a public address because he wanted a venue in which he could speak about free speech on campus. Mm-hmm. And I invited him, and we had another huge round of disputes that I was involved with. So I have been involved before with the cancel culture segment of the Georgetown community, which are both students and they're also faculty members as well.
Do you feel it's getting worse?
I think it has gotten worse in part. I don't know, because I don't do surveys, and I don't know if students have a different approach than they used to. But I do think the administration has, by allowing essentially them free rein, they've encouraged them to do this more than they were before. I think you do have to have an administration that's prepared to say, you're entitled to your opinion, but we're not going to take action.
Right. And again, this is all in the context of Georgetown as a private university. They have more room to kind of shut down speech than a publicly funded university, perhaps. But it's a bad thing, isn't it?
Well, but Georgetown has an official free speech policy that was modeled after the University of Chicago, which is actually exemplary. But which has now been undercut by this.
So they're kind of being fraudulent in advertising. They're saying, "Hey, we're a place of free speech," but then when you get there, not so.
Well, as of a month ago, when Ilya, when we received the report that outlined why what the position of the university was with respect to Ilya's tweet, we now realize we now know we are living in a different regime than we did before.
Final point. His name has come up a couple times. Mark Tushnet. He is a former professor of law at Georgetown. You took his office as he retired.
As he moved on to Harvard Law School.
I'm sorry. Well, you know what? Let's call that retirement. It's, you know, he went to a farm upstate, we'll just say. Okay.
Well, we could say he went to a better place.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, in any case, Mark,
Is it the good place or the bad place?
I don't, you know, episode by episode, that changes. You're never quite sure.
He went to the bad place.
Or the worst place, maybe. In a conversation I had with him about Clarence Thomas, he wrote a book about Clarence Thomas. He's a critic of Clarence Thomas, but he also said, you know, Clarence Thomas is working out a coherent, consistent philosophy that he's not given enough credit for. But in a conversation with him, he said, you know, the Supreme Court, you know, it sometimes it's a little bit ahead of where the public is. Sometimes it's lagging. But generally speaking, it doesn't. You know, it more reveals where the American people are rather than kind of sets the direction or dictates the terms. We're now in a world of, you know, where it seems like 6-3 Supreme Court decisions moving in a broadly conservative direction are set. You know, is the Supreme Court, is it way ahead of us? Is it way behind? Or, you know, is Tushnet kind of fundamentally correct that the Supreme Court, you know, more or less is kind of reflecting where we are as a society?
I mean, he's kind of right. I mean, I'd have to think about what metric we would use to figure out who the American people are and what they're thinking about things, given the fact we have a very diverse country and people are thinking different things. And we are at loggerheads with each other now more than we have been since the 60s. So in light of that, I don't know what you would necessarily say about the court. I mean, one way to look at it is sort of like looking at the racetrack ride at Disney World, where you get to steer a little to the right and a little to the left, but there's this metal strip in the middle that keeps you from going one way or the other too much. Maybe that's where the court is. It's a little to the right, it's a little to the left, and it isn't necessarily ahead or behind in any systematic way. Yeah. I mean, sometimes it really depends on the composition of the court. There is obviously the Supreme Court is what you would call a lagging indicator because the people of the age and accomplishment that get on the court are from a different generation than whoever's the young generation now. So there's always going to be a bit of a lag that way. And I think it's personally a healthy thing that the court can't change too much too fast, although obviously I'd like it to change 100% in my direction, right?
Yeah.
But so with the other side.
As somebody who, you know, who argued the Raich case, I mean, that seems like a century ago. And
I know.
Where is the federal, you know, where is federal legislation recognizing where America is on questions, not just of medical marijuana, but recreational marijuana?
Well, we got three votes.
Yeah.
We got Chief Justice Rehnquist, Justice Thomas, and Justice O'Connor. So we beat the spread.
in a more kind of sinister reading, the focus on the Supreme Court, one function that it might serve is to take pressure off of Congress to actually do things. Is that part of what's being revealed by the high drama surrounding Supreme Court decisions, which seem to be very amped up, certainly in this term? That may not be the case, depending on what cases are being settled, you know, in the coming years. But is that, you know, by talking about the Supreme Court, do we run the risk of really kind of focusing on the legislative branch, which seems to be very poorly administered these days?
Yeah, I mean, it's really hard to talk about the Supreme Court in isolation from the rest of the federal government. You have the Congress, which has really deep internal problems associated with it. And I would say almost especially in the House of Representatives, which has become a purely majoritarian institution run by leadership. I mean, it's actually majoritarian in the sense that leadership, it's not majoritarian, it's the opposite. The leadership gets to decide what to do and their caucus has to support them. Whereas before there used to be things like amendments to bills and committees reports and, you know, anyway, there's that. Plus there's the administrative state. So everything gets offloaded by Congress to the administrative state. And that empowers the president as well as the administrative state to do all kinds of things. We keep, you know, coming up with one executive order after another executive order. And when asked whether this is legal or not, my response always has to be, well, I don't know. What law has he invoked? Because tell me the law, because chances are he hasn't. He's only done this because there's been a law that gave him the power to do something. Now, I don't know what that law is. Tell me what it was. And then it turns out there's three laws or two laws that he's invoking the powers of. And they go, well, okay, what were those laws for? And is he really doing it? But Congress has sent, speaking of gun control, Congress has sent over to the executive branch one loaded firearm after another, saying, here, you use these guns as you see fit. Yeah. And then the president picks one up and decides to fire it and go, oh, my God. I mean, generally speaking, under our, you know, schoolhouse rock way of looking at government, it's the Congress that's supposed to be making laws. Right. And that's supposed to be democratic. That's supposed to be. And if they're not the only body, but they're at least one of the bodies, and they have offloaded the making of laws. So it's really hard to evaluate the Supreme Court in a system where lawmaking is taking place in the executive branch, and Congress has abdicated much of its responsibility.
I mean, Congress is kind of now, you know, they tried to, Republican majorities tried to say, you know, dictate the outcome of Terry Schiavo's life, a person in a persistent vegetative state. They are Terry Schiavo now. broadly speaking, and we'll end with this, when did you start teaching as a law professor?
What 1982. Year?
1982. So let's use that as a benchmark. Do you feel like, you know, and again, broadly speaking, from a libertarian perspective, do you feel like we're in a better place? Maybe not the good place, but, you know, and when you take into account all of the different things, you know, kind of run through all the spreadsheets and stuff, do you feel like, you know, the country is more libertarian or is it less libertarian, or is that not quite the right way to think about, you know, how societies evolve and change?
I am, you know, somewhat at a loss here, because I think when you evaluate the culture, there's all kinds of things that are at stake besides the libertarian issues of individual liberty per se. Like, what am I allowed to do? There's also what kind of schools do our kids go to? What kind of education do they get? There is the issue of free speech, of course, but then there's the issue of what are private institutions right. doing about speech?
Georgetown is a good example, right? You got to be downbeat on that, right?
Right, and if certain, you know, very very large companies start to take control of the organs of speech, and think about Twitter or Facebook or other places, if people, because of a lot of complicated variables, they are basically running our speech forums, and they're so-called private, but then they're also not, they're acting like Georgetown does. That's a threat. So I'm currently writing a memoir about my life. You know, as I turned 70, I felt it was time to get on the record where I've been and what I've done for the benefit of my grandchildren, because otherwise they'll never know. But my next book that I want to work on after the memoir is done is going to be called Real World Libertarianism. And it's going to be a rethinking of the model of libertarianism that I participated in developing with as a student when I knew Murray Rothbard and Leonard Liggio and Ralph Rako and Ronald Hamaway and all the others. We were involved in the Center for Libertarian Studies in New York in the 1970s when I was a law student. I was on the board of directors of that center. But that model, which was developed then, which libertarians have operated within for 50 years, has really never been updated or refined. And I do think in light of the experience of the last 50 years, it does require some updating and refinement.
And was
I think,
that, broadly speaking, that the focus and the energy should be at the relationship of the individual to the state, and that that's really what libertarianism is about, and as opposed to this broader question of how does power actually, you know, get operated and enacted? And
that's
like
what
that.
I mean, part of the job of the book is to try to figure it out. Mm-hmm. Because there's a number of different strains, and I'm a theory guy, and mm-hmm. so I think I can do this, but until I do it, I haven't done it yet. Mm-hmm. And so the whole point of writing a book, when I write a book, I don't write a book to write down what I already think. I write a book mm-hmm. to discover what I think. And so I can't really answer your question. I have some theories. I have hypotheses about what it's really about. I think it might really be about the fact that the libertarian model was not constructed with states in mind at all, mm-hmm. with governments. It's hypothesizes what would a government-free world look like. Mm-hmm. What would be the best policy for no government at all is what it was formulated at. But once you introduce governments into that, the model doesn't necessarily tell you what you should do. Hmm. So the model that libertarians have carried in their head, which I would call ideal world libertarianism, runs up against reality. And the model doesn't always work as it should. And so what is necessary, I think, is modifications of the model so that it ends up being real world libertarianism, which is what the title, my working title of the book is. How should libertarianism work in the world that we live in, as opposed to the model of liberty that libertarians like me were working very hard to develop in the 1960s and 70s. I joined in the 1970s into the 1980s. But it's been a long time since there's really been any rethinking of that model.
Wow, that sounds great, as well as the memoir. I've been talking with Randy Barnett of Georgetown Law School. Randy, thanks so much.
Thank you, Nick.